In this video, we're going to talk about the discovery of the structure of DNA. Once it was established that DNA was in fact the genetic material, we then had a race to figure out more about this particular molecule, specifically its structure. The scientists who ended up proposing the correct structure for this molecule were James Watson and Francis Crick. They were the ones who discovered that DNA was a long helical structure with matching base pairs. So how did they do this? Well, to determine this structure, they used their own knowledge of chemical structures, plus information from two other sources. The first was from a researcher named Erwin Chargaff. Now, Chargaff was a biochemist who would extract DNA from cells and then analyze the composition of that DNA. Recall, there are four different nitrogenous bases that make up DNA: adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine, or A, T, C, and G. And so what Chargaff would do is he would extract DNA from cells, and then he would assess how much of each nucleotide there was. He saw an interesting pattern. He saw that there was always an equal amount of A's and T's, and that the amount of C was always equal to the amount of G. But surprisingly, it wasn't just 25% of each, that the amount of A and T added together usually did not equal the amount of C's and G's. These became known as Chargaff's rules. And he published papers, this was known to the scientific community. This was information that individuals had access to. The next source of information that Watson and Crick used came from X-ray crystallography. Which is a technique in which an ultra-purified sample of a substance is crystallized, and then high-energy X-rays are bombarded at that subject. And as those X-rays would bounce off the crystal structure, the pattern that they make would give information about the molecular structure of that particular substance. Now, the thing is, Watson and Crick weren't the ones who performed this X-ray crystallography experiment, and the data that they used hadn't been published. Instead, a researcher named Rosalind Franklin was the one who was doing that X-ray crystallography data. She was working in the lab of a guy named Maurice Wilkins, and Wilkins was a friend of Watson and Crick's. And so when he knew that they were interested in the structure of DNA, he ended up showing them some of the data that Rosalind had produced. In seeing this data, they were able to correctly interpret it and figure out that DNA was going to be a long helical structure. You can almost imagine it would look like a twisted spiral, like the cords that used to connect old-fashioned phone headsets to the rest of the phone. So Watson and Crick were able to take this information and use it to determine the structure of DNA. They were able to conclude from Franklin's data that the molecule was a linear helical structure. They were also to determine from Chargaff's data that we're dealing with a double-stranded molecule, and that there would be base pairing, meaning that A would always be found on one strand and T on the other, C on one strand and G on the other. They put these pieces together, presented their model of DNA, and this resulted in fame and fortune and a Nobel Prize for Watson and Crick. Now, Chargaff's data was cited in their original paper, and even Maurice Wilkins was mentioned in the Nobel Prize, but unfortunately, Rosalind Franklin's contribution was not mentioned. This has caused a lot of debate and controversy. What was the reason? Was it because she was a female researcher in a male-dominated field? I think in part that could be the case. However, also unfortunately, at the time that the Nobel Prize was awarded, Franklin had passed away. She had died from cancer, and unfortunately that cancer likely was caused by exposure to radiation from the experiments that she was doing. Now, if Rosalind Franklin hadn't done her experiments, would we not know what DNA was today? No, eventually someone would have done those and we would have discovered the structure. But would it have been Watson and Crick who were the discoverers of DNA if they didn't have access to Franklin's data? Likely not. And so for that reason, I think it's very important to mention Franklin's contribution in the discovery of this structure. So let's look at the structure of DNA that they proposed. The model of DNA itself can often be provided as an analogy in the form of a rope ladder that's sort of twisted, the arms of the rope ladder being flexible while the stairs or the rungs being more solid. So it's like a rope ladder twisted into a spiral. Now, when we look at this structure and analyze it in that way, I'll show you several images or representations of DNA in the next slide, and I want you to notice that the bases pair in a complementary fashion. With A pairing with T and C pairing with G. So here we see several different representations of DNA. We have a ribbon model, where the sugar and the phosphate makes this twisted spiral, making up the ropes of the rope ladder, and the A's and the T's and the C's and the G's making up the steps or the rungs of the ladder. Now in the middle illustration, we see what the atomic model of these would look like, and we can see what's holding the A's and T's and C's and G's together are hydrogen bonds. And because of these hydrogen bonds, they will only form pairs with their complementary bases. For instance, if you had two A's together, they would not form complementary pairs with each other. Or if you had a C and an A, again, they wouldn't be able to make the proper hydrogen bond. So it really requires A pairing with T and C pairing with G. The last model, we see more of a what's called a space fill model in this computer model. And it shows what the DNA might look like at the molecular level. And so, the structure of DNA as they proposed it is composed of two long strands of nucleotides. The sides of this ladder molecule will be made up of sugar phosphate backbone. And this is really how the nucleotides are connected to each other in these long polymers. But then we also see the base pairing that holds the strands together. And specifically, these strands are held together because of the hydrogen bonds that allow those bases to pair in this complementary manner. And the strict base pairing rules are followed in DNA, that A always binds to T, G always binds to C. Now, because DNA is double-stranded, and because of this complementary base pairing, this suggests that it will be relatively easy to copy the DNA. If you recall, even though the early geneticists didn't know what the genetic material was, they knew that there were three properties that the genetic material had to have. First, it had to be easily copied, and we see with Watson and Crick's structure that each strand can act as a template for the other. If you have one strand of DNA and you have an A on one side, you know that a T has to be found on that complementary strand, likewise C to G. Another aspect that was established for the genetic material is that it had to store information. Well, it turns out that it's the order of the base pairs. It's the DNA sequence in these long strands that store the information. Information is contained in the order of the four bases. And these sections of DNA, they could be millions of bases in length. And the last characteristic of the genetic material is that it would have to be variable between individuals to account for diversity. And what we now know is that different alleles for a gene vary in their DNA sequences. So alleles have different DNA sequences. Now, when we actually look at this diversity within DNA, individuals of the same species will have slight variances in their DNA. Here, for example, we can compare a particular gene between human A and human B, and we see that there are some slight variations. However, if we look at that equivalent gene, but in an entirely different organism, like a chicken, for instance, will different species will have greater differences in their DNA sequence. And so the sequence of nitrogenous bases in a particular gene of person A may differ from that in the same gene of person B, and differ still more from the sequence of bases in a comparable gene in an entirely different organism, a chicken, for instance. So this was the structure of DNA as presented by Watson and Crick, and it shows how DNA can meet those three criteria of the genetic material. It can be easily copied, it can store information, and it can be variable to account for diversity. In our next video, we're actually going to look at how DNA can be copied prior to cell division. See you in the next video.